Morning, guys. All right, I got some fun stuff to go through today. This came up on the Facebook feed, and man, check this out. This is great. The ghost fleet of Mallows Bay, located in Maryland, USA. It is here that hundreds of ships were sunk, 230 alone, by the United States Shipping Board Merchant Fleet Corporation, with more than 100 of the vessels being wooden steamships, part of a fleet built to cross the Atlantic during World War I. Because they were built of wood, most of these ships were already obsolete by the end of the war, and the U.S. Navy did not want them due to the high storage costs. They were sold to the Western Marine and Salvage Company and moved to the Potomac River in Virginia and eventually towed to Mallows Bay in 1925. The company went bankrupt and the ships were burned where they lay. Only their hulls remain. Remnants of these ships and many others, some dating back to the late 1700s, also lie there, including an early 1900s four-masted schooner and many other vessels from the 19th and early 20th centuries. Okay. Now, yesterday I was hanging out with my boys, and one of them did something really dumb. And JD says to Barrett, "You're dumber than a bucket full of hair." And it caught me so off guard, I was laughing. But he was joking with Barrett. He wasn't serious. But dumber, if you believe this, you're dumber than a bucket full of hair. Okay? Yeah, without a doubt. If you believe this story, you are dumber than taking a 5-gallon bucket and collecting hair and putting it in there. You're dumber than that. Dumber than that. I don't know how else to say it. You're dumber than a bucket full of hair. Let's go through this story a little bit. Let's look at some of the pictures that we have here. And I wanna show you why I think this is, why you'd have to be dumber than a bucket full of hair. Look at all these holes in there. These are some of the aerial photos. I'm gonna go through some drone photos, but let me first go to Google Maps. Check this. Okay, so there's Mallows Bay. I'm just gonna pan out for a second here. Here's Quantico, and there is Washington, D.C. I guess this is the Potomac River. And you come into Mallows Bay. Now I want to show you something really interesting here. They didn't haze them all out. They left some of them. So those are all the old hulls of the ships that they burned and destroyed. And just so you know, those ships are all 300-foot long ships. So this is a big ship. I'm looking at ships that are 39, 40 feet. I'm like, whoa, you get up to 60 feet. You're like, holy smokes. 100-footers are insanely expensive. Schooners and stuff, they get to 90, 300 feet. Insanely, insanely. Wooden boats, right? And of course, almost impossible to get an old wooden boat. I can see why right now. I see why, what they've done with them, because they didn't build them when they said they built them. I'm going to show you their story. I'm going to go to this guy called It's History. I'm going to fill you in on this, but look at this. So this is just Google Images, but look at, all of a sudden they disappear. Why? They don't want you to see how many there are. They don't want you to see everything else. They only show you a few as you go in, and then they just haze it out. Remember I say they do this all the time? They don't give us full idea of what's there. Okay, so let's go, let me show you some drone footage. Music's a little bit annoying. So this is where there's a bunch of different drone footage of this. They say it's the biggest graveyard in the northern hemisphere or something. Ship graveyard. Okay. So I was so funny to me, because I was like, wait a second. It's the biggest. Like, as if any of them should exist, as if it makes sense to have a graveyard for beautiful boats, as if that makes sense. But then it's like, hey, this is the biggest one. I'm like, well, where are the other ones? What are you talking about? Like, do you see how dumb that is? It's like acting like this thing that exists, that testifies that they hate us, that we have abusers, that we have people destroying things from another world, that's just, oh yeah, this is normal. Like, accept it. Accept that they're just destroying ships. Right now, I want to first just go over like the history of it, because it's so ridiculous. It does not check out. This wouldn't check out to a normie. And I see that in the comments. The normies are like, wait, what? Wait, what? Come again? This doesn't make sense. Let me show you some more stuff. Okay, so this guy is Ryan Sokesh. It's history. Total controller. Oh my gosh, nuts stuff that he says. The stuff that he says is priceless. But okay, so he's gonna sort of try to explain why this makes sense in terms of the real world. And as you read the comments, you realize there's the shill bot saying, oh yeah, good. But then there's some people like you and me in there going, wait, what? And then there's some normies that are like, how did that pass? Why was that the solution? And what is wrong with our government? Right, I want to talk about our government today. Ooh, man, do I want to talk about our government. And I want to talk about our abusers, those who hate us. You know, there's something that happens with women sometimes where they're in a relationship with men that the man is an abuser. And the women somehow like end up defending and loving their abuser still. I don't know how that happens. We knew somebody in that situation, probably a shill all along. But what I realize now is there's a weird dynamic that happens with the abusers, right? And then finally you get a little distance from them and then you see how bad it is. Same thing with a cult. Like, you couldn't see it, the abusers. I thought Father Farnsworth at that cult was like God's ordained man for... I literally thought they were going to be writing like a third testament about our school and people there as they did like the most amazing things, right? That was the twisted world. So you learn to love your abusers. That's the relationship people have with their government right now. They love these people that are abusing them. It's crazy. But so this is Ryan Sokesh. He covers an amazing amount of things so good on his channel, because he'll actually, you can springboard off of him to find out all these weird things that he's trying to like be like, there. If you found this and you're like, well, what the heck are all these sunk ships here? He's going to try to explain it away. But just listen to some of the nonsense he says.
These men are building ships. These are their weapons of war. The drill, the rivet and the blowtorch, and that giant crane swinging high out over the yards.
As new military technologies are developed every day, and the landscape of modern warfare seemingly changes faster than most are able to keep up with.
Okay, so one of the comments was great in this. It's like, as he says that, I literally stick weld the exact same way that they're stick welding on this show. He's like, wait, as things change faster than we can keep up with, like, so that voice right there, that's Ryan Sokesh. Okay, and every sentence he starts and ends has the exact same cadence, and he's a bot. He's an AI generated nothing person. He's just kind of a stooge, an AI stooge trying to make this world make sense, even though it doesn't. Trying to make this stuff make sense. The reality is they've sabotaged all the ships, all these beautiful steamships that we could have gone up to the Camp of the Saints with, and they've destroyed our ability, trying to destroy our ability to go to the Camp of the Saints. But he's going to try to make it seem like it's not that bad, and the government, sure, they may have made a couple blunders here and there, but they're good in the end. So just listen to more of him. Ugh.
It is a perfectly reasonable question to wonder what happens to the older military hardware that is now obsolete, especially when it comes to massive structures, such as aircraft carriers. My question is, what happens specifically to warships that are no longer needed? Well, there are numerous paths that an outdated ship can follow, but one popular destination for ships that the U.S. Navy has no immediate use for is the Mallows Bay in the Potomac River. Here, there are hundreds of vessels laying dormant in the water, waiting to be scrapped or sunk. This is commonly known as the Ghost Fleet of the Mallows. An interesting, extensive collection of history with a location that deserves to be explored. So today, we discover the history of the Ghost Fleet at Mallows Bay. I'm your host, Ryan Socash, and you're watching It's History.
Okay, so that's the type of way he does everything. Like, whether it's the Singer Building in New York that they had to tear down, build a, you know, butt ugly box instead of this beautiful building, or any number of millennial reign structures that came down, you know, he's going to try to be like, there. So check it out. It's really great to reverse engineer what they're doing here. But I would just want to go through the story first of all. He does an ad for a long time. So here's the, let me get over to here.
However, the vast majority of ships that lay in the water here are from World War I, which was more commonly referred to as the Great War at the time. Of the 200 ships at Mallows Bay, hundreds of these vessels came from a government-funded project to mass-produce ships in order to support the war effort. But obviously, this program didn't pan out for several reasons, and the remnants now lay dormant as shadows of their former selves. You see, when war broke out across Europe in 1914, after the assassination of Franz Ferdinand, the entire continent, as well as many areas across the globe, were plunged into a massive war, arguably the worst conflict the world had seen up until that point. While the United States was not yet the world's undisputed superpower, it was still a regional leader in the Americas and was recognized as a rapidly rising power. As a result, it quickly became a possibility that the U.S. would enter the Great War. Despite President Wilson running his re-election campaign on the basis of neutrality and winning, he knew that if something major occurred, the U.S. may have to finally take part, and therefore, he prepared. This sentiment was accelerated with the enactment of Germany's policy of unrestricted submarine warfare, which transformed merchant ships into prime targets, reinvigorating the Navy. So as 1917 came around, the situation would deteriorate swiftly, in particular after the sinking of the RMS Lusitania at the hands of a German U-boat, which killed over 100 Americans. And this was compounded by the interception of the Zimmermann Note. So anti-German sentiment had grown so large that Congress...
Okay, sorry, I stopped it there, hoping it wasn't confusing, but so... Ship after ship being sunk, right? They're just getting rid of these ships that, again, would take us to the Camp of the Saints. This is, you know, I love finding this stuff because I go, this is so fishy. But this is, I think, why it's so hard to go. Right now, I look at the sailing vessels available. I look at what, how hard they've worked to destroy these things. I look at this story, for example, a little snapshot. This is... They've done this everywhere, okay, everywhere. So I'm just going to fast forward a little bit to this part where they build all these ships and then destroy them all.
Corporation had to find alternative materials to build their warships. As we've looked at before in several videos on this channel, one avenue was concrete ships. However, another low-cost option was constructing ships from wood. Seriously, the corporation had ambitious plans to create a fleet of 734 wooden steamships to support the war effort, with most of these wooden vessels meant to serve as merchant ships that transported valuable supplies across the Atlantic to U.S. troops overseas or American allies. This plan was also beneficial given that wooden ships could be put together much quicker than normal steel ships, not to mention that the U.S. has a massive supply of timber. Paradoxically, the large plan that the Emergency Fleet Corporation had set out never came to fruition, as long delays and a shortage of available workers saw insufficient amounts of timber arrive at the shipyards. The shipyards themselves were also understaffed and underpaid, making construction slow and behind schedule. So when World War I came to a close, a mere 98 of the intended 734 ships were actually constructed. Then, out of those 98 ships, only 76 were able to carry cargo, and those were riddled with issues, from mechanics to construction shortcomings. Not a single one of these ships ever sailed to Europe. However, this ultimately...
Okay, so let's just go over this. Look at what they're saying they're building. And then, all of a sudden, they can't build ships anymore. They could build ships. All of a sudden, they're riddled with problems, right? What? Come again? Like, how? You guys can make ships like crazy for hundreds of years, and then all of a sudden you guys forget how? And showing us all these pictures, it's great and all, but they, why all of a sudden are these ships just useless? And how much money did you spend on this? What kind of, you have 76 300 foot steamships, and what are you going to do with them now? What are you going to do with them, Ryan? Tell us.
Did not have a negative impact on the war effort, as the U.S. was still able to maintain a large and effective navy, and in general, the American entry into the war was the catalyst that led to victory. The war came to a close only about a year and a half after American troops set foot on European soil, meaning that the fleet of wooden ships was never needed, even if they were built on time. But still, with the war over, the shipping board had a new issue at hand. What were they to do with the fleet of 98 unused wooden ships? The first thing they did was appoint a special committee to sell these ships, which were already obsolete, hastily put together, and many were simply incomplete. All the same, a scrapping organization from Alexandria, Virginia, called the Western Marine and Salvage Company, came and bought most of the fleet and transported them to the Potomac River. And this next part serves as a shocking illustration of wasted government money. You see, the overall project cost the U.S. government around $300 million, and yet they sold it to Western Marine for less than $750,000. The company was able to salvage some very valuable materials from each ship, but once there was nothing left to take, something had to be done about the hulls. The empty shells of these wooden ships were just sent down the river to their final resting place in Mellows Bay. Now, the bay was already crowded, and hence, to make extra space, 31 of these vessels were intentionally set on fire on November the 7th, 1925, in what would become the greatest destruction of ships in a single event in U.S. naval history.
Wow. We've got to burn them. What are we going to do? We just spent all this money, did all this stuff. We got to burn them. Right. Remember I said that dumber than a bucket full of hair? The story's dumber than a bucket full of hair. And if you believe it, you're dumber than a bucket full of hair too. Okay, this is not what happened with those boats. This is, again, they make just totally unbelievable stories up. And somehow people believe them. Okay, they've dumbed people down so much, they think they're spinning. They think they're spinning and there's upside down people in Australia. They think that. They think that this story checks out. Okay, their brain is kaput, totally kaput. But I point this out because I think, will there ever be a straw that breaks the camel's back? Will they ever see that we have abusers, those that hate us, you know, as they chem us constantly, change our weather, block out our sun? Does anyone see that and go, we have abusers, our government is abusing us? Is the government, as they make this story up, and they go and destroy all these millennial range ships, does anybody see that we're being abused? We're being, this is terrible. This is terrible what's happening to us. And this is not right. This is all destruction of what was built during the millennial reign of Jesus. Man, do I get fired up about this stuff. Because once you see it for what it is, you know, we're under attack every day. Let me keep playing some of this.
Over the next few years, Mellows Bay became a dumping ground for many old or abandoned ships. By 1931, Western Marine and Salvage Company had amassed over 169 ships in that location. However, the effect of the Great Depression took its toll, and the process...
Okay, so you see how war is always utilized. Great Depression... printing press, Industrial Revolution, they have these like sort of catchphrases that as soon as they say them, they're about to lie to you. So all these ships, like, oh, they just amassed more and more. Let me remind you, there's this ship here locally that my neighbor's son works on called the Stephen Tabor. It's a beautiful ship. They say it was built in 1762. And they say it was a cargo ship for bricks and lumber. Of course, it's not. It's just a millennial and beautiful, beautiful ship. You got to pay thousands of dollars to go out for a week on it, okay, and eat, great food. It's just gorgeous on the inside. Okay? Thousands of dollars for this stuff. That was built as a wooden boat. What's wrong with the wooden boats? Are wooden boats bad? No. Wooden boats are beautiful. There's plenty of, Lindsay sent me this picture of a boat that went, gorgeous boat that goes down on the maiden voyage, right? And they pull it up and put it in a museum, and it's something out of, it looks like a fairy tale boat. Let me see if I can find a picture of that. Okay, here it is. Centuries old Swedish shipwreck, goes down a maiden voyage. Okay, so look at this thing. So they're going to pretend to have built it, and then it sinks on the first, like as if the millions and millions and millions of man hours that it would take to do this, and then they go sink it on the first and be like, oh, whoops, we didn't quite think of something. Like, right, look at that. That was built during the millennial reign, along with all these beautiful buildings. And it was sunk on the release of Satan. Satan's release to deceive the world sinks these ships. Why? Because we could pack a lot of people on there. We could get the hell out of this place. That's why. So these are just ships that were sunk during their maiden voyages. Not even just the ones that they say got caught in some war or something. And like Titanic, right? They say maiden voyage again. But this story gets recycled over and over, and people don't seem to notice. Not everyone. I do. But some people notice. But, they've not only used Mallows Bay, they just sink them in the ocean all the time down below. Oh, you can't go here. It's the same thing. San Diego, I know, or San Francisco had a whole place where they burned a bunch of tall ships too. Oh, we don't need them anymore. What? We don't need tall ships? Oh, so you burned them in the bay? Just like this story. Burn them over here, burn them over there. Sink them in Maine. What the hell? That was good. That was the start of a song. Burn them over here, burn them. And it just gets to be, it's either I start going loopy crazy or I laugh. I don't know. Manic laughter. This was great. This is a great meme. I got to see if I can find this. Okay, this gave me a great laugh because I can relate to every bit of this. It's when the apocalypse is probably near, but you can't take it seriously because you're so numb and jaded from the disaster marathon that started in 2020, which also feels like only a year ago, but it's actually already 4. And I keep doing this. I'd be like, I've only been awake 2 years. I've only been awake a year. And I'm like, wait, it's 2024, fake 2024, but I woke up in the beginning of 2020. So it's been 4 years of this disaster marathon. Oh, I loved it. Like, we're living through a disaster marathon. And, you know, I love it. Normies are realizing we're in a disaster marathon too. And they're waking up to it in their own ways. And as we sort of see what's going on around us, it's, you're either going to laugh like these maniacs or you're going to cry. And there's a lot of things that they're doing right now. They're blocking out our sun. We know that. And Beth and I had it was 7 days straight without the sun. And by the seventh day, we were fighting like stupid, petty fights. Like, we knew it was nothing. You know, those nothing fights. You just keep going. And we go, I finally said, I think I just need the sun. I just need the sun. I this is stupid, and I'm not very reasonable in a fight. Okay. And I still want to like make my point, but, I knew it as we were going that it was the sun. It was the lack of the sun that was causing this. And, on top of everything, all the ships and buildings and transportations and vaccines and all the lies, they're also blocking our sun. Wow. Doesn't make you feel desperate. It makes you feel a little bit like scattered and like, like these guys. And this is where, maybe this is what we need to do, is just a little bit of that. I don't know. Yesterday, JD said something. And God's laughing. And I was like, man, it's good to laugh. Oh, it's good to laugh. It's hard for me to laugh about all those ships being destroyed. But that's kind of what we need. That's my next thing.
Sitting in the water, slowly being reabsorbed by their surrounding nature. It took some time for people to notice, but when they did, the Ghost Fleet now took on a whole new persona as an incredibly unique environment, an unusual hybrid of man-made structures being incorporated into the natural ecosystem, so much so that the House Committee on Government Operations officially declared that a distinctive ecosystem had developed here. Therefore, removing the ships would damage the environment. From this point on, the Ghost Fleet has become a bustling habitat for various types of water-based plants, reptiles, amphibians, fish, and various other forms of life. All this has resulted in the Mellows Bay becoming a tourist attraction, but also a prime target for scientific exploration, fishing, and other outdoor activities such as boating,
Okay, so do you see how stupid this is? Now, this dump where they put all these things, somehow they're going to twist this into like, this is now good. Now this is good. This is good. Yeah, great ecosystem. What have we just done here? Well, we've created a wonderful ecosystem for the birds. They can land on these ships. Well, no, they didn't need the ships. We could have used the ship, guys. We could have used it. Hey, you didn't know where to store them? You couldn't figure out where to store them? Is that the problem? So you go burn them and sink them in a river? They should have had a few more guys and taken them out into the ocean and sunk them good and deep. Okay, this was a mistake. I don't know. Maybe they didn't know the Little Season was going to go on this long. And people were going to get drones and figure out, whoa, you guys got sunk a bunch of ships here. But here we see it. And, you know, sometimes I think, I wonder what Satan knows and doesn't know about Little Season. I wonder what he knows and doesn't know about the Bible. You know, I think his vision is in some ways stunted. Like, if he knew that crucifying Jesus would result in his defeat, wouldn't he have not done that? Right? If he knows that the end of Little Season culminates in him surrounding the camp of the saints, wouldn't he be doing everything in his power not to do that, right? So that they can keep doing this, perpetually, you know, being in this. Why wouldn't they be like, oh, that's the end of it all? Then I go into the lake of fire, you know, speaking. Then he goes in the lake of fire. I won't speak in his third person. So wouldn't he want to not do that? You would think that with all his cleverness, he would avoid these things, but there's some shadow over his vision, and it's prophesied in the Bible that he has to do these things, so he will. I don't know if it's just despite himself, he has to lie, father of lies. And oh, that's an interesting thought. I just said it. I don't know. Maybe that's not that interesting, but I was thinking maybe he, just because of his inclination to lie, he ends up doing what he even knows leads to his own demise. But I don't know. That's kind of a weird thought. So let me pause this. All right. I just thought of this, and Bethany knows. Oh, let me grab Beth.
Hi. So this is my friend Vive. Hopefully she doesn't mind. I'll just do first name. And she and her family are traveling in that very awesome little home you see in the picture. Her handle is at ARK, A-R-K, 888-AZ, like Arizona. ARK 888-AZ.
AZ, yeah.
And she has this great video.
This is great. You know, Asher is going to love this one. I'm going to tell Asher that right now. So she presents the EGI Troons in the Little Season in a way that is palatable.
Yeah.
Right? Because a lot of times people start talking about inversion and people go, ooh, and they run away.
And right? She doesn't do any pictures or weird stuff that way. She's kind of explaining the background of like what it is and why it matters and what it's doing in this little season.
Yes. And, you know, Asher says this, and I think it's true, is that this is massively important to understand. Okay. Mm-hmm. Now, I don't know about accusing everyone under the sun of it, but I think it among them, they're all inverts. Okay. Mm-hmm. Now, just see, again, people are already probably, oh no, I don't like when people talk like this. Well, it is what it is. This EG, the way she says it, it's like, you know, this is their posse. This is their group. This is what they do. This, like, it's hard to accept, but they've perfected this. And so they've been hard at work in a lot of ways that we don't know. Mm-hmm. And this is one of them. They've been very hard at work. They're very diligent. They're very good at fooling us. Mm-hmm. And so check that out.
Yeah, yeah. The broad sweeps of how the theys are involved in this kind of thing. I think she really puts it well. Yeah. I mean, it's some of it's a theory, I guess. But yeah, it's
well, we haven't even seen her other videos, but
no,
but we didn't even tell her we were going to show them.
No,
I hope she's okay with that.
I hope
her
so too.
Girls are on there, but you know, a lot of people get afraid for their children, and I remind them and my wife and myself all the time is they would have no power over us had it not been granted to them from above. And a lot of people are big wimps about criticizing the government, right? And Beth, I was saying to them, you know, once you understand that our government is the abusive husband against their wife, that somehow people are like still placating, you know, mm-hmm. It's really sick. Like, wait, we can call out this big fat bully that is abusing us. Mm-hmm. We can call it out. Mm-hmm. We should. And it's really, it's obscene not to. And it's very wimpy and bad and spineless not to.
Well, okay. And there's sorry. I think it's hard to know how
to
say you're not involved. And it's some interesting beta on that. So some online friends of ours here were talking about getting a ticket for merely walking out on a pier that was closed, and they ended up being able to get out of it fine. But someone advised them that within, it's like 72 hours or something, if they were to return the pieces of paper that were this supposed ticket, saying no contract, that can void it. And that's the kind of like intel we don't necessarily know, but it's the official way of saying, you have no contract with me. I have no deal with you. You have no jurisdiction over a law-abiding citizen walking on a pier. You know, there's just no contract. No, you don't have any authority over me. And so, anyway, I don't know tons of background on that. And when she found that out, she said they had passed the 72-hour mark, so they did still just go in and.
Yeah, well, and a lot of that stuff, I go like, what's the 72-hour magic like? Is that's still within their rules? And why couldn't you just do that right away?
I was gonna say, I think ideally when you're face to face, you're like, I am committing no crime. I have committed no crime. Mm-hmm. So, I'm a living person. Abiding.
You know. I watch these things all the time, guys, online on YouTube, and you don't have to sign anything, right? You can. They want you to sign, but you don't have to sign. You don't have to sign stuff. You don't have to sign it. So
or
you don't have to
take the paper, right? Is that part of it too?
No, you can take it. You know, there's belligerent stuff where they sometimes get they can make things worse. So this is not my expertise.
Yeah, but reminding us that we're not under them in all the ways they would like us to think we are, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. So that schooner that now the Navy or the Coast Guard has to inspect everything, it's like, no, your guys' requirements, they take what they can get, right? They take what they can get, and that's they'll just keep taking.
Can I add the Angel Army thing to
Angel
you?
Army.
I was just reminding another friend of these things of not being afraid. And there's that story with Elisha asking that this young man's eyes be opened to see basically the angel armies. That's not the right word, but that are surrounding the city, protecting it. And, you know, that's, I think, a really good image for us that we, again, God has the ultimate power and his army has the ultimate power. And we can assume that when we're living according to his will and we ask for help, that those armies are there. Mm. And they, the bad guys can't have any greater power.
Right.
So.
Good. Yeah. Good. Hey, while you're here, I wanted to say a quick request for people. We have a friend dealing with migraine headaches. Okay. This community of people that knows what's what. Any help for that friend of ours, because they're at wit's end with it. And I think we have a headache regime that we do. But any ideas besides ours, first of all, we pray, because considering angel armies, we think some of these were attacks.
Mm-hmm. And acknowledging that, you know, God has created us and he's does have power over our bodies and how he created them, and ask that he would relieve the pain and get rid of any evil in the body that may be causing this.
Right. And but man, some of these migraines are just debilitating. This was like a year ago, but we had a couple of them. Mm-hmm. I did and you did. We were throwing up. It was like, you want to die. Headache. Mm-hmm. Kind of.
Yeah. Really,
and,
really,
you know, we know people are having that right now. And what can we tell them? How can we help them?
Yeah.
So any ideas? I'd love to be able to pass those along.
Yeah. We do peppermint essential oil on the temples.
Oh, yeah.
We do,
but migraines they don't touch
ice,
migraines. Yeah.
And we do, of course, darkness for the
now I make lead here. Let me hold up my lead. This thing is on the ground right here by my bed. We use it for a grounding pad. It's a piece of lead. It's real malleable.
You need
No, I don't need you.
Okay.
And I believe some of these attacks are, you know, they call us tinfoil hat conspiracy theorists, right? Because wearing tinfoil hats, right? Why would you make fun of people wearing tinfoil hats? Is that crazy? Did people before, like, that's an old expression, tinfoil hat wearing. Like, did they used to know what was going on and we're only now make fun of it? Like, as if there's some bad thing out there that would want to send electromagnetic pulses at you and give you a headache, migraine. As if that was real, right? As if they drop chemicals on us. As if they destroy ships in the harbor and pretend like it's all okay. As if they tear down beautiful buildings and as if. Okay, well, we know that's if. That's true. And so I take every precaution and I wrap my head in that. And I haven't had them for over a year. We get little headaches. I think they're chem headaches in the frequency stuff. I think there's a lot. We put our things in airplane mode often. We don't sleep with them beside us. And probably the best yet is to get rid of them. And you know what I noticed, guys, is when I talk on the phone, I'm a left-handed holder. So I'm like this. You know what tooth broke and is cracked? Is this tooth closest to where my ear is the one that cracked on a cashew about 6 months ago and is breaking and falling apart. And I wonder if I just have done this so long and if the just proximity is what softened that tooth enough to make that happen. I don't know, but I just always know that when I have a phone, it's up to my left ear. So. And I used to wear Bluetooth. I used to work with two Bluetooths in my phone, right in my pocket. And I would just listen to stuff for 6-7 hours a day sometimes. Sometimes I worked alone. Terrible for you, brain. But, you know, your body can heal. teeth not so much, I don't think. Man, actually, teeth can heal way more than dentists say. That's what I keep hearing. There are ways to rebuild, and they'll say it's over. Well, once your tooth is cracked and is disintegrating, I think it's just gone, which is where mine's at. But you really can recalcify. There's lots of things that you can do in complete opposition to what the dentists are saying. You don't need fluoride. You know, we have friends that have never used fluoride in their life. All their children's teeth and their teeth, they're great. And they own a organic health food store and never have believed in fluoride. You don't need fluoride to harden your teeth. And it does harden your teeth, but it also does a lot of damage to your body. So, man, what am I doing? I'm going to get banned on YouTube again. So let me keep going. All right, I'm going to get myself in trouble here. I'm going to get myself in trouble here, big time trouble. But that. Okay. That. Okay. One more time. Okay. That. I can't do it. I can't do that. That hair thing. You know, there's ways men move and there's ways women move. I can't do that. Okay. Asher, I think you're right. A lot of people have told me this, and I go, oh, no, come on, guys. Come on, can't there be some people that aren't? And WTF. That, why is that bear always there? Guys, there's something that I'm sad about. I'm happy to sort of get out of it, but I'm sad to like realize the reality of it. I'm going to read some comments for a second. Okay, so I noticed this too. This was interesting. So these three got their minions to overrun your comments to try to shame you and make you look bad. That's a trick of Satan. I like how you stood your ground. You guys are being inundated in the comment section with the enemy. Can't compromise with secret societies. I have been with you from the beginning. Agree. Alpha has Masonic symbols all over his channel. He is a 33 FTM. His buddy Kingdom Within the same. The redhead is an FTM. You can't argue with skeletal forensics. I saw Paul and another video talk about karma and beliefs and special reincarnation for the millennial reign. These guys are wicked. So, well, here's a real interesting dilemma. JT was talking about me, but he was like, I don't even want to mention his name, as if I was an anathema, a leper among the lepers, right? My comment on these three guys was that they seem to be aloof from what the reality of this is. Like, we're literally slogging through it. Same with Shelley. We're literally slogging through it and being ostracized and hated. And these guys seem to be tiptoeing through the tulips, like as if these things don't affect them, right? Well, that's just not the truth. This is, it's not only divisive. This stuff is, you see that there is a force that's programmed to go against it. And that's what I'm commenting on. And all of a sudden, it's amazing to me that JT will talk about his undying love for Truth Unedited, who I don't even know, and how he's still a brother in Christ. But to say that you're a shill, right? And Truth Unedited, by the way, is saying that these guys are deceived and they're not even Christians, not even saved Christians. But now me saying that it's weird not to call out shills. Like, it's weird not to see that Josh with Founded Earth Brothers, that Dean Odle, that Midnight Ride, and now Truth Unedited, probably a host of others, are really using similar arguments and really laying into the Little Season. It's weird that these guys aren't calling that out as a sort of systemic attack, as a barrage of attacks from Satan. Satan's utilizing them to attack. It's weird these three guys don't see it, especially for who they are, who they claim to be. You go, no, this is pretty easy. Why don't they see it, right? And now the comment section, I go, look at this. It's like there's another playbook that I don't know of. And I'm not in the crowd. Guys, I'm sorry. Hate me if you want. for saying this, but I can't associate with guys that like these three guys. I go, this is not the sniff test. They're failing at it. See how desperate Satan is to grab hold of truth and steer it in his direction? It seems to be always his plan. Always, he's always got to control the opposition. And I don't think it's any different with these guys. Shills be shilling, as Margo says. Margo, I think you're absolutely right. Shills be shilling. And there are hallmarks that I look for. Again, the money thing. I think that's it. That's a huge one. Now, Jason Jack, I have a lot of hope for, and I really like the guy. And he seems like a guy that I can relate to as far as what he's doing. Not to say everyone has to turn, everyone's like, oh, you got to believe exactly what Theron does in order to be safe. No. Let me read you some more comments. These are the comments I go, okay. Okay, I see that. But there's a certain type of comment I want to expose. So this comment, I see this, why is Paul charging $126 for a signed copy of his book, which isn't even finished yet? GoFundMe, the younger generation, is a bit like trying to use Harry Potter to teach the children. Jesus did not do any of these things. You know, I do think it's creepy to combine money with this. Guys, it can't be done. You cannot serve both God and man. You just can't. This is very high level deception. Okay. So anyone that's about to defend these guys, this is what I think, guys. This is what I think. You won't change my mind on that. I see it now through the comments because I go, oh, wow. It's just like with Dean Odle or any of these guys, you get the minion comments. Here's where the rule book doesn't work for me, guys. I have no subscribers. I'm going to leave. This I love this comment. This guy is right here. Show you this one back. Yawn, you're off my list. That's to me, right? Wait. You're acting like an entitled customer at a grocery store or sports store, and you're like, customer's always right. And I'm like, first of all, you don't know how to spell your. But go thy way. Like, if I have 3,000 subscribers or if I have 10, you know, who cares, right? It doesn't matter to me. If this is a platform I've got, I'm going to say what I don't have the rule book. Nobody sent it to me. I haven't figured this out. I test all these things and I of course expect shills to be shilling. So then I have all the hope in the world for these guys. But then when they don't call out Truth Unedited as a branch of, it's like being like NASA. It's like, oh, those astronauts, you know what? We can forgive them. We can forgive them. Wait, they're all working in collusion together against us. All those guys are working in collusion with Satan against us, against the truth of God's word, I should say, not against me. And that's worth calling out, guys, all three of them. Okay. It just doesn't work to me anymore to give them allowance. Okay, and I get a lot of this. I already told you guys these are not men. Satan's armies are troons, and it's not about the Bible. It's them against God. It should only take one look to see them. You know, I know people tell me this, right? I'm not saying this is the first time I've heard this. I just have held out a little bit of hope, and I'm telling you now, not anymore. Oh, I meant to say this, real side note. Did you catch that these guys, if these guys find Brigadoon, you'll call me. Brigadoon, idyllic mythical village that doesn't appear on any maps. Oh, man. Yeah. So that's on that TV show that I played a clip of. If you find Brigadoon, let me know. Look at this. Definition Brigadoon. Legend of Brigadoon. The story of a mythical village in the Scottish Highlands. The village becomes enchanted centuries ago, remaining unchanged and invisible to the outside world, except for one special day every 100 years when it could be seen and even visited by outsiders. This enchanted day is spent in joy and celebration. Wow, that's funny, because I wondered why they included Brigadoon in that clip. I didn't know what it meant, but there it is. Okay, I got this email too. Hi there, just saw your video critiquing Alpha, Paul, and JT. I saw that video and felt uneasy when they called these brothers, these shills brothers in Christ. I agree with you 100%. They are not brothers. This is not a time for that sort of brotherhood. This is black and white. We're either with Jesus or with Lucifer, period. I cannot agree with you more. I get accused of being black and white, and I go, well, things are black and white. Where's your gray? I don't have gray. This becomes a sitting on the fence issue otherwise. Those guys are vile shills. They're pushing the narrative and towing the line, just like the medical people during COVID. Exactly. I also agree that COVID, most of these agendas have nothing to do with money. The money only comes into play to bribe the little people whom it's created for, to keep them enslaved in the system. Good point. There is money involved, but it's more for, like, could be tempted by money, right? And I could do some things, but the whole system isn't about money. That whole system is not money. They feed off a negative. The controllers don't need money. Absolutely not. They don't need it. They feed off negative energy and suffering and anger to survive. They're total antithesis of God. Just the same way they turned the fire departments into superheroes during 9/11, they played the same card during COVID and turned these despicable medical people into superheroes who were complicit in killing innocent people. Oh, that reminds me of something. So I was reading Ezekiel 37, 38, 39, and I was studying, there's some bad horns, which I think were, the carpenters came to the rescue. The Bible sent the carpenters. I may not be Ezekiel, but I've always been like, those guys are heroes, those guys are heroes, those guys are heroes, those guys are heroes. I said, the carpenters are never heroes, right? Well, like, you never hear anything good about carpenters in the media. And, but all of a sudden the Bible has this verse about the carpenters coming to the rescue. I loved it. I can't even remember where it was, but it made me smile because I get sick of applauding military, doctors, fire department, and whenever I'm reading kids' books and they're always like making the hero like fire department, I always change it to carpenters. The carpenters came. Anyhow, that's funny because she's got the same thing. The same way they turned the fire departments into superheroes during 9/11, they played the same card during COVID and turned these despicable medical people into superheroes who are complicit in killing innocent people. Anyhow, this is where, I just reiterate, I don't know the rules here. I often feel that way. I often feel like somehow not in the group. I don't fit in. I don't fit in with those guys. And I want to believe in people. Not that I've thrown everybody out. I like Ricardo and Shane. But I don't like that when people associate. Like, I did a show with Paul early on. What's going on? JT criticizing me, saying he who shall not be named, like I'm Voldemort or something. Meanwhile, he's like, I'm not even going to mention his name, who this guy is. Well, that's really funny to sort of make me the one that is we got to ostracize him, not the guys that telling us that we're going to hell for what we believe. Oh, the guy who's saying that we're shells. If you're not a shell, why don't you talk about those who are attacking the truth? Why don't you talk about how they're coordinated? I've done all these videos dissecting the stupid things that they say. Josh from Founded Earth Brothers, he can't believe the nonsense coming out of his mouth, right? You can see that. It's nonsense. It's word salad nonsense. Why don't they point that out, right? Why don't you point out Dean Odle? What he's saying is nonsense. Freemasonic nonsense, and he's in a pulpit. Why don't they point out Midnight Ride? Those guys aren't real. They're not legit. It doesn't make sense. Just change that one little thing. They're trying to do this thing. They're there, sure, this is all true, but there. Just settle down. It's not a big deal. We can all get along. We're all saved. It's not a salvation issue. No. They're trying to take hold of the truth and steer you guys, right? This idea that we have champions, we have people that are our guys. I don't want that feeling. That's the wrong feeling. It's like we all read our Bibles, and I do this to try to encourage people to break these systems and these the whatever MK Ultra mind jobbers they try to do on us, and we're free. We're free thinkers, and we're allowed to read the Bible and believe what it says. We're allowed to do that, and we're allowed to label people. Like, one thing none of them did, none of the comments was like, well, what about when Jesus says, any of those that deceive a little one, be better for a millstone to be tied around his neck and cast into the deepest part of the ocean. What about that? Right? These guys are lying to little children. What about that? Shouldn't we call that out? Yeah, we should. We should. None of them respond to that. They just go, oh, we don't like you. You're like, No, come on, hit me with something real. Okay, guys, and I'm not the only one seeing this. Keep your amazing energy. I have seen some concerned trolling in your comments. So concerned, but they are truly worried. They want to plant fear. They are calculated in the Father, in Christ. I truly think so. Open doors. Just felt so angry. Pretend to truly care and help even deceivers. Right. Some of the comments were so like, they're just scathing, and then at the end they go, be blessed. And I'm like, what, you know, be blessed after you, you know, took 10 minutes to write? Well, it's a shill probably, but you don't end it, be blessed, right? The Bible says, don't say Godspeed to those you don't mean it to. Don't say Godspeed to the blessed. You want to now bless me and my, this is what I'm doing. I'm calling out shills. Right, well. I'll take a blessing from the Father, but I can battle fear, so I'm cheering you on. The humor and mockery, biblically sound theology. Okay, likely you both see through the concern trolls, but I just needed to cheer you on and blessings and add you to my prayers. Okay, so, oops, I meant to, oh shoot, I'm sorry guys, I meant to cover up their stuff. I'm sorry for these guys. Oh, I hope I don't make you guys a target. I should have done this. Okay, now pretend like you don't know these things. So I appreciate this, guys, because I do need that, because sometimes I'm like, man, I'm upsetting people, right? Well, if I'm upsetting the sort of the minion bot crew that came over, and if you find yourself in a criticized, you've been one of the criticizers, I realize you can get caught up in this sort of like, but those are my champions. I'll choose them over you. You know, I have a lot of people say that to me. I choose Dean over you. I'm like, whoa. So what? Go. Does he's got war paint on right now. I'm going, Pastor Dingo Mascari. You got him? I'm fine. I don't want you to have me. I want you to cling to the Bible. Hey, I think a lot of the negative comments here might mean, well, but they're missing the point about needing to avoid shills and being mindful that there are many among us who masquerade as the body of Christ but have ulterior motives, especially in this little season. Exactly. Right? As if we should pretend like there aren't any in this crowd. This lashing out by these big YouTube channels against the post-millennial view has been very revealing, totally different story when it comes to today. So these, you know, people are seeing this. People are seeing that it's a weird attack, and then to call them brothers in Christ, that's not legit. That's not real. All right, last comment. I appreciate these three guys discussing the Bible and also explaining we don't have it all figured out. Theron wasn't bashing these three guys. He was talking about wolves in sheep's clothing controllers. It became more apparent to myself that we have a lot of what we think are our brothers in Christ actually aren't. That's it. A red flag for me is when special guests come on to JT Alpha Talks and understand conspiracy with a reputation of being very educated about certain topics. They seem to be able to pronounce and remember a lot of facts about history, and I think we need to be cautious and more careful about deceivers, wolves coming into the flock. Exactly. JT did a whole thing on Josephus, and I thought, but Josephus is full of shit. Why would you sort of like confuse our minds with saying, you know, Josephus said that this all happened. It's Nero. I go, no, not so fast. I mean, we've got the Bible. And if anything conflicts with the Bible, then we throw it out. Does Josephus conflict with the Bible? Yeah, throw it out. Throw it out. Sure, he talks about chariots coming, but then he describes a world that's not the millennial reign. World. Throw it out. They should be able to see that, right? They seem to be able to pronounce and remember a whole lot. Yeah. In Biggest Financial Con Men, they talk and talk and talk. Very, very refined storytellers. We need to be careful about a lot of people. Satan's agents have demonic possession, which make them expert storytellers like Dean Odell. We can expect to start seeing these demonic agents working up. Nine-dimensional chess playing, for example, tell us 10 truths mixed with one lie. It's okay to discuss your concerns. We are in the age of deception and expect big talker Betty Crocker guests in the future. 100% more, 1,000% more snakes, wolves than we could ever imagine. That's it. Guys, if I could underline this, this is what I'd say. It's just, it's sad, but it's true. 100% more snakes, wolves than we would ever imagine, that we would ever want, that we'd ever want to admit. It's so disheartening that you really should just pull the plug on YouTube. That's what I'm getting to, is this, like, oh shoot. If it's always just this nonstop, this confusing, what's the point? You guys either think I'm genuine or not. I am genuine, but I know I can't convince people of that. And I don't know how to, I'll just keep doing what I do. And if people keep watching, then I'll keep going. And let's see, I had some stuff from the Bible that I wanted to talk about, but this has already gone on a really long time. It was about Ezekiel 37, 38, 39, and I wanted to study who the Valley of Dry Bones were. Okay, so Ezekiel preaches. Maybe I'll talk about this next time, but I'll just sort of lead into it. He preaches to the Valley of Dry Bones, and they're resurrected. And then I think that's them being brought into existence prior to the millennial reign and for the millennial reign. And David is the king, and he's their king. So again, that's maybe I'm wrong, but I'm kind of wondering if that is a depiction of the 144,000 virgins. So, but I could be totally wrong on that. Maybe I'm still studying that and trying to figure out what that is. The reason I like this is Ezekiel 38:39. Is anybody that's mixed up with Philip Smith, their brains are going to get twisted into a pretzel as he tries to convince us that the Gog Magog war of Revelation 20 has already happened in Ezekiel 38:39. It's not true. This is a war that did happen. And I want to prove that those are different events, and that when they come up on the breath of the earth, Gog and Magog, they're resurrected, okay, reincarnated to come out and go at it again. And people that don't believe in reincarnation, well, Gog and Magog get to come back. Satan gets to come back out of the ground. What do you call that? There's plenty of people that live again. Even Jesus says that John the Baptist was Elijah who was for to come. If you could accept, this is a hard saying. This is who he is. John didn't even know who he was. John the Baptist didn't even know. Well, there's some interesting things there, but I want to study that more. So that should make me a lot more friends, eh?